presenting the Working Class Academics Conference. Just to give you a word about the recording, we're going to be recording the first part of this session, sort of the presentation bit, and not recording the questions and answers at the end. I'm going to be moderating panel, but I'm doing that in a very hands-off way. So my role here is really just to take questions and store them for the panel later on. So I think with that, I'm down first, by the way. So if you want to private message me, Annie, if you don't want your question publicly, you can do that using the chat function. Just a reminder, if everybody who isn't speaking could have their microphones muted and their web cameras switched off to save on bandwidth. So with that, I'm going to hand over to the panel to introduce themselves and to start the panel session. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much for that, Darren. Hi, welcome everybody to the Working Class Academics in the Library panel here at CALC 2021. So I thought the first thing we'll do is just very quickly introduce ourselves. We're a group of organisers of the Working Class Academics Conference. So Joe, over to you first. I'm afraid you're muted.
My name's Jo Forster. I not only study the working class and co-produce research with working class learners, but I'm working, but I am also a working class woman from Northeast England. My heritage being that my family came from Ireland when it was colonized by the British during potato famine of the 1840s and travelled as starving immigrants to Consett to work in the steelworks for the next 140 years until Margaret Thatcher closed down the works in 1980. My father was a steel worker. I returned to learn in my 30s as a young working class mother with two girls in the early 80s and over time achieved a BA honours, master's and PhD and have worked in different roles in community adult education for almost 40 years in deindustrialized communities. My PhD thesis examined how people living in the former coalfield and steelmaking communities of County Durham have experienced deindustrialization and what role adult education plays in such contexts.
Thanks, Joe. So my name is Andrew Preater. I am a librarian working in a modern university in London. I'm from working class backgrounds and I have a professional interest in working class experiences of education, and particularly how libraries as spaces and services support or can support widening participation in higher education. Okay.
Hi everyone, Kay Sidebottom. I'm a lecturer in education and childhood at Leeds Beckett University. Most of my career I've actually spent working with mature students who in some way have been disenfranchised from education. So mainly working class students who have had huge barriers and challenges being in academic spaces. And working class background from the south of England, and really interested, I think, in a material lens. So thinking particularly about libraries and spaces in terms of their effective nature and what that does in terms of student access and participation.
Thanks, Kay. Shona?
Hi, everyone. I'm Shona. I am a biracial working class woman, recently graduated with a master's degree, and I'm a firm believer that everyone has got knowledge that comes through inadequate experiences.
And Hina?
Hi, everyone. My name is Hina Suleman. So I've recently graduated with a master's in education and educational leadership and management, and I'm currently a PhD candidate. I participated in last year's Working Class Academics Conference, where I shared my story about being a working class lone parent and a woman of color who was faced with boundaries of culture and labor and labeling. And whilst being aware of my realities, I'm very much interested in talking about my representations of minorities and diverse voices. Thank you.
Finally, we have Lisa.
Hello, good morning. Oh, good afternoon. No, it's good morning still, sorry. my name is Lisa Taylor. I'm an academic. I teach education studies and early childhood studies at University of East London. I studied in a Russell group, but I'm really, really pleased that I work in a post-92. I feel that my skills are valuable for working class students. It's something I really resonate and identify with. I'm also very interested in Freirean teaching, progressive education, and Marxist theory of labour, alienation, and production.
Thanks, Lisa. So I'll just really quickly say how we'll work the panel discussion, how it will work today. So I have a very quick introduction from me, and I will aim to keep things under 5 minutes. We'll have some other short talks from two of our organisers from the Working Class Academics Conference. They will present some ideas about social class, libraries and education. I want to ask, as speakers go through these short talks, can audience members ask their comments or questions in the chat in Zoom? And we'll come to all of your questions at the end of all the presentations in the panel discussion. So I just want to say that we particularly want to welcome reflection, input and questions from those who are from working class origins. And as has been mentioned earlier, to facilitate open discussion, the Q&A and panel discussion will not be recorded. So I'm actually going first with a quick introduction to this. I want to just ask this question really about what is in the library and who is in the library to get things started. So last year at the first Working Class Academics Conference, I presented a talk about working class experience of libraries and sketched an idea about how library workers and academic colleagues might recognize and represent working class knowledge and lived experiences in our library services. The Working Class Academics Conference really presented a unique and welcoming space. And we want to bring some of that spirit, some of that outlook of our conference, which is in July this year, to CALC today. That spirit is one that identifies working class not as a problem to be solved or as a passive recipient for middle class knowledge. On the contrary, we unapologetically celebrate the rich knowledge. And employing here Professor Tara Yosso's term, the cultural wealth of working class communities. So yeah, my key question is, what is in the library? Who is in the library? Now, I just want to say, of course, we know this, but just to reinforce it, libraries are online spaces too. And the importance and some of the limitations of that have never been more clear than this last year during the COVID-19 pandemic. In a typical academic library, the majority of what we spend on information resources is usually online. Online provision like journals, databases, and those increasingly costly ebooks. Now, I want to draw on an argument here from Anne Goulding about libraries and cultural capital. So she speculates that libraries can be seen as holding a large reserve of cultural capital, which we then make available to our users. That idea is from Pierre Bourdieu originally. And I know he is often criticized for very opaque writing, very dense writing. So what I mean simply by cultural capital might be called instead cultural knowledge. So what the library then has is a large, intentionally selected reserve of that cultural knowledge. And our functions in selecting and collection development does make us a legitimizing agent for that knowledge in the eyes of students and colleagues. So critical question there really is, whose ideas and knowledge are represented in our collections? Or to repeat Tara Yosso's question, whose culture has capital? And it's primarily the knowledge of those who've shaped and are reflected in dominant or mainstream ideas about learning and education, which is the middle class. So in asking who is in the library, I want to ask who libraries make most welcome in academic spaces. Academic cultures or mainstream ideas about universities do present a particular norm as a type of ideal student. So that is someone who is independent, studious, and fits behavioral norms of our spaces. And certainly that is someone who is middle class, white, able-bodied, neurotypical, and also embodies other privileges. So students from such backgrounds don't tend to question their place in academic spaces or the right to belong in such spaces of learning, whereas unfortunately working class students do. And thinking about this, I was really reminded of Diane Ray's work, and particularly the paper I cite here about working class identity, finding or losing yourself. And she argues that an education system set up the way it is really in the service of middle class interests. Finally, in terms of who is in the library, well, of course, there's the staff. What about library staffing? And unfortunately, most current information on this is the CILIP and ARA workforce mapping survey from 2015 didn't address social class as a diversity indicator. But it would not surprise me if library workers here from working class origins had an overall sense of this, about what things are like in their workplaces, and perhaps some experience of masking working class origins or performing middle classness fit in. And that is maybe something we can talk about in the discussion. So in summary, I want to say for library and education workers, our taken for granted assumptions, our shared or common sense is a middle class common sense. And it connects with ideas about library neutrality, ideas about meritocracy in higher education, and also to acceptance of deficit models, which stigmatize working class students and communities as lacking in terms of their knowledge and experience and confidence. So these are very interlinking and self-supporting issues and are complex, but I want to suggest working social class as a lens is one key, one way of understanding some of this and thinking about some of the ways forward. So that is me, I'll stop there. And I'd like to hand over to Shona. Now we're going to attempt to, I'm going to attempt to hand remote control to Shona at this point. You let me know you've got that, Shona. There we go.
Yeah, it's come through. Hopefully it works. Right. Hello everyone. Please bear with me. This is not my first conference, so we're trying to just figure it out. Okay, so I want to talk about the library as a space of solidarity, because one thing I've noticed in my experiences is there is a lot of erasure in these spaces, but that erasure doesn't mean that we don't have knowledge to add. And I think it's quite important to reflect on. So, yeah. Andrew, I don't think it's working. Oh, it is. Right. How do I go back? So I begin by talking about Mignolo, because Mignolo's work reminds us that class is just one inequality. There are lots of others that intersect, and obviously class doesn't act alone because of that. So while European modernity emphasised scientific thought, it wouldn't have been possible for Western capitalist gain to happen without these coexisting discourses, expanding on what it means to be human. So with Renaissance thought, it acknowledged the human ability to think and act with free will and rationally, whereas coloniality intersects with that to act, to exclude Black people from this definition of humanity to justify colonialism. So we had enslavement, the looting of resources, and our dehumanisation. So what we have then is the economic development enabled through inventions like steam engines, allowing mass production for trade in factories, as well as a division of labour around money where the working class are exploited. At the same time, Black people are excluded from wages for labour because of the socially constructed ideas of our subhuman status during this time. Physical features were demonised, whereas white people's beauty was assigned. These biological applications were then used to uphold us as the uncivilised opposite of whiteness. Likewise, we also see how our male and female sexes are considered as biological facts, and our masculine and feminine genders are considered the socially expected logic of this. Through assertions of men's masculine strength, we see how women's feminine nurturing qualities exclude us from this definition of humanity too. Queer people and gender non-conforming people are also excluded, because we have to remember that patriarchy is heteronormative and cisnormative. Otherwise, those opposites couldn't happen. Ultimately, we see how white men have constructed themselves as the only rational human being, while locating everyone else as their inferior opposite. It means that while speaking of class is important, ignoring its relations to other oppressive structures leaves others at the mercy of erased knowledge and physical harm. Illiteracy in Africa, for instance, wasn't a thing before colonialism. Knowledge was actually shared through generations. Our values, cultures, and history were passed on. When Europeans invaded and colonised, our truths were invalidated because Eurocentric thought was enforced. Cram's study, therefore, reminds us how important it is to challenge what we mean by illiteracy and where this definition stems from. So this violence still wreaks havoc on our lives today. Alibi's American study reinforces this with findings like 17.1% of Black people and people of colour having their education underestimated in their job as librarians. Similar results happen in England, with Ishaq and Hussein identifying that 44% of Black people and people of colour experience racism from work colleagues and or service users in libraries. So everything I've discussed so far shows us how Eurocentrism claims that oppression is a fact of who we are, rather than taking responsibility for its enforcement of harm by erasing our truths and asserting its dominance. As Steve Biko said, we must seek to restore Black people the great importance we used to give to human relations, which leads me into my next point, academic resistance. As Andrews and Palmer discuss, I actually hate technology at this point.
Back a few slides, Shona. Let me see if I can do that for you.
Yeah, can you do that, please? Thank you.
There we go.
Thank you. If you move it on to the, yeah, thank you. As Andrews and Palmer discuss, Black studies, which takes a multidisciplinary approach to our histories, politics, and cultures, has American origins, which means it's less prioritised in British institutions. That being said, since Black British people do have our own histories and experiences, the introduction of these courses to our universities is revolutionary because it presents the knowledge that it's both possible and necessary to speak on our truths. We can also extend this to Black feminism's American origins and how Black British scholars in this area are demonstrating this same consciousness about the multiple truths we all have. Do you want to flip it onto the next one? Thank you. Of course, not everyone can afford to attend university, so people have limited access to this information. These class divides, as bell hooks mentions, prevent us overcoming any form of inequality. Sisterhood could not be powerful as long as women were competitively at war with one another, she says. Andrew, can you do the next one, please? Thank you. So possible solutions then. Online spaces could be one way of sharing this information by way of a possible solution. The Free Black University, for example, developed last year in response to Black people's decentered position in education due to colonial constructions of knowledge. Its aim of redistributing knowledge and mobilising accessibility can, however, be noted in several other ways alongside of this. While challenging racism, it also disrupts class inequalities by releasing free ebooks, as well as overcoming inaccessibility, because people like me who have sight loss can actually zoom the text in and use screen reading software, which is great. Next one, please, Andrew. Thank you. So with all of this in mind, I'll leave you with a few things to consider. Could it be that libraries are more than the public buildings that we know? Could it be that they're more than the shelves filled with books and quiet spaces to study? Perhaps it's more about the interactions we have, the shared truths in our communities, the accessibility of resources, the affordability of texts, and the centrality of people who are marginalised because of systemic inequalities, the solidarity that is both possible and necessary for our collective wellbeing. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shona. I think I've also lost my video now, so my apologies, everybody. That's not on purpose. I'm going to attempt to hand over remote control now to Joe. I think we'll see how this goes, Joe, but if you want, I can control the slides for you. let me know.
I haven't got a coming up with loading.
Yeah. Bear with me a second. That should be working. Hang on, let me just control it. That's a bit strange. What's going on there?
I've got okay. No screen at all.
Bear with me. Bear with me. I'm going to try something else. Hang on. I'll just stop sharing for a second.
It says I'm controlling Andrew Preater's screen, but I've got
working. That's working, Joe, but unfortunately we've got some kind of technical problem. Could you stop controlling my screen, please? Yeah. Bear with me. Hang on. I'm just going to try and rescue this. Okay, my apologies. I've just had a problem with Google Docs. So bear with me a second, everyone. I've got a backup of this on PowerPoint. I'm just going to load that. Might be super quick. And bear with me. I'll share that screen again. Right. Could you let me know when you can see that, somebody?
I can see it now. Yeah.
Okay, there we go. Okay. Let me just page through really quickly back to your slides. Go. Okay, Joe, you should be good to go now.
Yeah.
And let me just assign remote control to you again.
Yeah.
Do you have that? Thank you.
Yes.
Great stuff. Thanks, Joe. Apologies for that, everybody.
Right. I haven't got the little arrow at the bottom left-hand corner.
Have that, Joe. It's been done in PowerPoint now, so that doesn't exist in PowerPoint. So if you just use your back and forward arrows, that will take you through your slides. Or if you like, just control the slides for you?
Control the slides and I'll tell you when to move forward.
Yeah, okay. Right. So okay. Go for it.
Right, got it. For the next 10 minutes, I'd like to talk about the industrial working class and how they came to be fixed through no fault of their own, through neoliberal policies that fragmented their lives, families and communities from the late 1970s. We now have students studying in the universities from these communities who have experienced intergenerational poverty for many decades, both young students and also adult learners who have returned to learn through second chance adult education in the universities. And many of them are first time in their family to attend university. So there's a lot of vulnerability and emotion in them entering university life. In pandemic times, they've actually lost education or been excluded from education when they've actually returned home to their communities, or sometimes if they're just living within their apartments in the cities where the universities are. And this is due to digital and data poverty that they financially can't afford. Now, my presentation seeks to explain why this should be the case. Can you go to the next slide, Andrew? Next slide, Andrew? Yeah, no, yeah. According to Skeggs, by the end of the 19th century, the working class had become a knowable, measurable, and organizational category. historically positioning the working class and representing them as having little value through the prism of middle class values has pathologized the working class as different, thus lacking respect. The desire for respectability by the working class is not just a historical memory, but is part of their class struggle and is alive today. Being working class is about inequality, exploitation, and living on a daily basis with the class gaze of moral judgment and subjectification of a political elite, the media, and middle classes. The working class people internalize this feeling of negative representation of themselves, which Raymond Williams called the structure of feeling. Next slide. Class matters. To think that class does not matter is only the prerogative of those unaffected by the deprivations and exclusions it produces. As Ray points out in this slide, the working class rarely choose the discourses within which they position themselves. They are produced by the more powerful in society. Two narratives that will confirm this are deindustrialization and austerity that fix working class communities into areas of deprivation with high levels of socioeconomic and health inequalities. Next slide. Deindustrialization is the dismantling of the industrial base of this country that happened in the late 70s. And industries such as coal, steel, shipbuilding, manufacturing industries were actually deindustrialized, and communities lived around these industries and were dependent upon them. And the economic shock fragmented these communities and brought about social trauma. So deindustrialization must be understood against the background of neoliberalism as an economic and political project, not just in ideology, but also in policy and in practice. And it restructured the economy and reduced the size of the state, and in doing so, also restructured working class relations and experiences. Deindustrialization brought a loss of respectability to the industrial working class, who lost their given identity through traditional work that's been reconfigured into the precariat, who live with anxiety and fear due to insecurity of a precarious labor market and few protection rights. Deindustrialization is not a one-off event. It has long-term effects on communities and on people. And these neoliberal strategies, the governance, have brought significant transformations in working class communities, restructuring their way of life from one of routine work, gendered organization of work, kinship practices, and collective security to one of individual anxiety and communal fragmentation. These communities have not recovered since the 80s. And then we had austerity kicking in 2012. This is where the government actually bailed out the bankers on taxpayers' money and brought savage cuts to public expenditure and sweeping reform of the welfare state, which scarred individuals, families, and communities disproportionately in the working class communities. So it was the poorest in our society who were dependent on welfare and public services who were actually hardest hit. This has actually brought about incredible health inequalities once the pandemic emerged. And although we know that the pandemic is a global contagion, I'm talking predominantly about our country here in the UK. It's impacted again on the hardest of those in poor health and on low income who are living in the deprived areas and overcrowded conditions. Now, when Praruga wrote this, I think that, which was last year, we now know that it's the Black and Asian and minority ethnic communities who have suffered the greatest through the pandemic with health conditions, because the social determinants of health, which are things like how good housing, education, you know, food, you know, lack of, you know, food insecurity, all of these things contribute to people having poor health. And the combination of that and any kind of medical condition, these chronic conditions of asthma or diabetes, etc., can, and the fusion of the virus actually hits these groups harder. Next slide, please. What happened to our students in the pandemic? Well, really, it would have affected them because of the socialization was affected, loss of education and exclusion from education. And this has prevented the students from humanly flourishing in the communities. And of course, they've had a loss of you know, conducive learning spaces, and limited devices or no devices within their own homes to actually study. So it's had cascading effects on student life. Next slide, please. So let's have a bit look at working class education. Historically, the main purpose of the working class, of educating the working class was for the economic prosperity of the country. Their education was seen by politicians and elite as being in economic interests of the country rather than benefiting the lives of children. The comprehensive system is seen as meritocratic because previously we had a grammar school system from the Education Act of 1944 that separated children through the 11 plus exam. And children were separated from their friends when people went on to grammar school, and mainly the working class went into the secondary system, which was very similar to the system that had gone on from the 1870s through until the 1940s after the Second World War. But the comprehensive system at the moment, it retains its powerful remnants of the past. We still have a middle class system in which working class education is made to serve middle class interests. The working class for low pay, sorry, I can't see because of the writing on the screen. Schools continue to prepare the working class for low paid work rather than for academic success. Can I have the next slide, please? So, education of working class children in the auspices of raising levels of achievement through testing and assessment has caused psychological hidden injuries through fear of failure, loss of confidence, and fixing of failure in the working class reinforces us. They've always been subjected and put down rather than liberated. So today, what we're seeing is due to certain policies and targets to encourage working class children into universities, we are actually got working class young people seeking to reclaim their respectability through a university education that previous generations through poor education, poor working class education and deindustrialization prevented this from happening. And as I say, many of them will be first time from their families going into university. So it's a whole family experience, really. Can I have the next slide, please? Thank you. So this is the Office for Students definition of digital poverty. And I'm not going into it because most of you will know what I'm talking about. Next slide, please. Thank you. Next slide. A university education for working class students must be understood within the context of social inequalities, social injustice, and inequity. Now, the pandemic closed down schools, colleges, universities, community adult education, the voluntary sector, and libraries. working class students and adult learners had to find a conducive learning environment outside of the campus walls, and many who come from working class families on low income have no or limited access to IT equipment, devices, connectivity to participate in online learning due to financial poverty. Their priority is food and not connectivity in many cases. Next slide, please. To me, the virus has imploded inwards onto the universities and onto adult education providers in the communities, producing an additional inequality, that of digital and data poverty, and which has created loss of education and for some exclusion from education. To me, the problem lies outside of the universities, as it's been brought about through structural inequalities, social injustice and inequity in working class communities. Its solution lies in public policy for working class communities and families, in providing policies that provide student grants, hardship fund, living wage, secured employment, childcare provision, decent housing, income distribution, welfare state, that provides a safety net and not the strict welfare state that we have now, an investment in ICT internet infrastructure across these communities. Universities as academic communities in lockdown have been very benevolent in trying to educate their students by moving online. The belief that working class students can access online learning through digital technology, can access online learning and connectivity disregards the fact of the social and economic inequalities that play a part in these students' lives that create digital poverty. Next slide, please. The Joint Information System Committee has actually written to Gavin Williams, and this is actually what they have actually said about the possibility of a lost generation of young people who are missing out on their education, causing distress, harm, creating really inequalities long into the future if their education is lost. And that is in particular in relation to disadvantaged students. And they've identified that it's critical that 1.8 million university students who have access to learn remotely have equal access to data and devices. But half of higher education students are digitally disadvantaged, and it will be the working class who are in the higher part of that 50%. And then it talks about many families are at risk of slipping into poverty due to the pandemic and can't afford the data costs. But the issue is that many families were already in poverty, you know, at the time of their students coming in, their children going into university. So digital and data poverty is the main issue that is preventing effective delivery of online learning in the universities. Next slide, please. And TET calls us in pandemic times, we need more than ever to look for resources of hope that enable us to engage in struggle and action together for our learners. Thank you.
Very much, Jo. Bear with me, I'm just going to stop sharing, hopefully. Okay, I think I have my video back now as well. Jo, thank you very much for that. Okay, so just to let you know, everybody, our slides will be updated. There are a couple of references missing on our slides. My apologies. An updated version will be sent through to the CALC organizers as soon as we can. So that's got all the details. So we've omitted to show the slides there at the very end with the references. So in preparing for this conversation, one of the things that we talked about was a reflection on working class students' experiences during the pandemic. So just one of the initial questions to kick off, I wanted to ask,